Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you can all hear me. Welcome to today's talk. A few notes before we begin today. Since many of you I have yet to meet in person, I'll just introduce myself to begin with. My name is Shaina Parekh, and I organize these educational talks on the weekends. And if you'd like to be added to the group, please send me a message. My phone number will be in the chat box. This talk will be recorded and it will be sent out on the group chat. I will also send out information on the group chat about MAM's weekly classes for both adults and kids. And finally, we kindly request you to keep your videos on so that MAM can see her audience. Our talk today is the non-existent difference between Advaita philosophy and physics, or as MAM so sweetly likes to put it, where Einstein stops, Adi Shankaracharya takes over. Our esteemed speaker today is Padmashree Ma'am. Ma'am is a retired professor of physics of Mount Carmel College. As a devoted disciple of Swami Chinmayananda, he developed a deep interest in the study of Hindu philosophy under his guidance. I have known Ma'am and attended her talks and lectures for the past 2.5 years. Every single time, I walk away with one thought, and that is how lucky we are to have such a person among us who is not only so gifted in vast areas of knowledge, such as physics and philosophy, but who is equally generous with her time and her talent. She treats each lecture as if it is a graduate level seminar, paying meticulous attention to each and every thoughtful detail, and drawing analogies and telling stories wherever needed to guide her audience along. You instantly feel that you are in the presence of a true academic. As we all know, this is a particularly unique time in humanity's history. Worldwide and in India over the last few weeks especially, almost every family has been affected. When our family was personally affected, I found myself gravitating towards philosophy, as many of us tend to do during times in our lives where we're thrown out of balance. Oddly enough, though, I also found myself wanting to learn more about quantum mechanics and the laws of energy. Soon enough, the two worlds of physics and philosophy came to a natural meeting point. And during one phone conversation with Ma'am about these topics, the realization hit, as it has done so many times before, that I was speaking with one of, sincerely, the rare humans on Earth who was an expert in both of these areas. And the realization, the second realization that hit was that perhaps many others would also like to hear Ma'am's thoughts on these subjects and the intersection between these subjects. And that is how today's talk was born. So we again sincerely thank Padmashree Ma'am for being with us today and generously and gently guiding us through these vast areas of physics and philosophy. With that, I warmly welcome Padmashree Ma'am.
Thank you, Shaina. Namaste to all the viewers assembled over here. The topic for today is physics and philosophy. Is the audio clear? I just would like to know, because there is current fluctuation over here.
Yes, ma'am, it's clear. We can hear you and see you.
Okay. So this also is a very vast topic. Physics is vast. Philosophy is also very vast. And therefore, we are indulging in something which is very impossible. Therefore, as brief as possible, in a nutshell, I'll try to put in whatever thoughts I would like to present today. It'll be with a small little introduction, And then we will go into the illustrations part, wherein we'll get a little bit of an insight or a glimpse into how physics and metaphysics, or we can also call it as science and philosophy, meet each other or they merge with each other. Now, this was in 1980s when I was a professor and I had just joined there as a lecturer in the physics department, Mount Carmel College. And then I was preparing the classes in preparing for modern physics. That's how we would call it those days. One of the papers that our final year students had was modern physics, wherein we have quantum mechanics, Einstein's theory of relativity, uncertainty principle. I'm just using a few words over there. So these were all over there. E is equal to mc squared, that famous Einstein's equation, particle in a box, there are many topics over there. So I was preparing for this class. This modern physics, or I'd like just to put it in a very ordinary terms, it's higher physics. It's very, very conceptual, very abstract, looks very vague. We feel we have understood, but we really have not understood. There is always a question mark inside because we can't comprehend and apprehend. There is no experiment which the teacher can do in front of us and show it to us, or we can go to the lab and perform some experiment and see for ourselves whatever theory we are learning in the class. It's very difficult. So therefore, as I was preparing for the class, I suddenly felt that this was not physics that I was reading, but this was an Upanishad textbook, a scripture that I was reading. I felt like that. Very many scientists earlier have written, there is so much of material about the sameness between physics and metaphysics. They are one and the same, just applied in two different fields. But for me at that point of time, because till then I also studied examination standpoint. We were also students earlier. So we really never get into what exactly is the similarity between physics and philosophy. So I really felt that this was a scripture that I was going through. And not only that, I found that whatever physics I was trying to prepare, it all fell into place. I understood very clearly. And later on, I felt that my students also were able to understand it very, very clearly. So basically, the physics that was there in front of me was the scriptures, the philosophy, the Upanishadic truths rewritten in physics language. It looked like that. So immediately, I wrote a letter to my guru, Swami Chinmayanand Maharaj. Like I already said, it was the 1980s. So I wrote to him a letter saying that, I don't remember exactly what I wrote, but this is the gist of what I wrote to him. I said, it looks like I am reading the Upanishad, either a Keno Upanishad or a Mundaka Upanishad or a Kato Upanishad when I open my physics book to prepare for my students. And I feel that my philosophy has taught me more physics than the physics that I learned when I was a student. That was the gist. I promptly got back a letter from him, and very beautifully he wrote back to me. It's there in his own handwriting, but I am reading it out over here for everybody. So I'm quoting Swamiji in his letter. He wrote, "Once we have grasped the substratum for all, the adhishtana for all things and beings, all other knowledges come to full integration, all confusions end, and all incongruities get liquidated." I'm repeating. Once we have grasped the substratum for all, the adhishtana for all things and beings, all other knowledges come to full integration, all confusions end, and all incongruities get liquidated. Substratum or adhishtana means the platform, the foundation, the basis for the entire universe of things and beings. So therefore, the message was very, very clear. Philosophy or Vedanta, this Advaita philosophy, which we relate to Shankara, it transcends everything. The higher we go, many things get into it, get included in it. So therefore, at the highest level, philosophy, yes, does transcends all. But when it transcends everything, then does it include everything? Yes, it includes everything. That's the beauty of our philosophy. It transcends all, and yet it includes everything. So this is a little introduction that I wanted to present before you all. Now getting back into our science and philosophy, both are fields of knowledge. Our physics, chemistry, mathematics, science. I am dealing with physics. The same thing holds good for mathematics and chemistry also. We know as we go higher and higher and higher, branches of knowledge start converging. We have physical chemistry, we have mathematical physics, we have biophysics. See, biology comes in, mathematics comes in, physics comes into chemistry. So all of them have started already becoming more and more closer to each other. But all are knowledge. So what is it that the physicist or the scientist is searching for? And what is it that the philosopher is also searching for? Both of them are trying to search and seek for that truth, which is there, or the essence behind this universe of things and beings. There is some truth. There is some reality behind all this. Nobody can deny that. What is it? Is the search and the seeking. Both are doing the same thing. They're in parallel, route paths. So the physicist also is doing the same thing. The philosopher also is doing the same thing. The only difference is, I'll tell what the differences are. When it comes to the scientist or the physicist, he's trying to find out what this truth is in and through the universe of things and beings. Because basically, chemistry is dealing with elements. Mathematics is dealing with numbers. Physics is dealing with matter and energy. So he's trying to find out what is that truth that lies behind all these things. Means in and through everything, he's trying to find out the truth. The philosopher on the other side is trying to find out truth, not through anything, not in and through anything as it is. I don't want to see truth through a pair of glasses. Because if the glasses are tinted, I will see the truth also colored. I want to remove all these paraphernalia, the equipment. We must remember, when we say equipment, it's not only laboratory equipment. Our body, mind, and intellect are also equipment. So I want to see truth as it is. It's an ocean of a difference between the two. So when the physicist is trying to find truth in and through, he's obviously working in the outside field, outer field, objective field. The philosopher is working in an inner field. It is subjective over there. Now, what is the instrument that the physicist has for all his investigations? The only thing he has got is the intellect. No doubt it is a very sophisticated equipment that we have. That is why we are called as roof and crown of creation. He is using this intellect that he has to go beyond the frontiers of the known and reach out to those realms of the unknown. Only intellect can do it. But the philosopher is not using his intellect. He is using intuition. This is an objective equipment, the intellect. Intuition is a subjective equipment, if we may use the word equipment. What does the intellect do? It thinks. Thinking is the process that we use for our investigation. So it's a process, it's a doing word. So the intellect, what it does is it thinks, it's a doing word. What does the intuition do over there? There is no doing over there. It's awareness. We say, I am thinking. But we don't say, I am awareing. It's not a doing word at all. It is just being there. See, there it is becoming a thinker. I'm becoming a thinker. Now, this up till here I thought of. Now I move to the next stage. See, everywhere it is, I am becoming, I am becoming, I am becoming. in the case of a philosopher, there is no becoming there. There is only just being, the state of be attitude, be hyphen attitude. That's where our masters are. So what word is it? It is a being word. I'm just putting down in simple, simple language. If that is a doing word, this is a being word. In physics or in our sciences, we are participating there. Very rigorously, we are participating in whatever we are searching and seeking. So I become a doer over there. I'm accomplishing things. And of course, when I'm able to discover whatever I wanted to discover, I am enjoying it also, the fruit of my investigation. See, the doership and the enjoyership attitude come over there. In the case of a philosopher, it is, I am just an observer. I am in the be state. I exist. That is why we say I am present, ma'am, means I am in the present. Observer means sakshi. Those who are familiar with our philosophy will be familiar with these terms also. Develop the sakshi bhava in you. So we become a witness of everything, not only the universe of things and beings, our body, our mind, our intellect, our likes, our dislikes, our habits, characteristics, tendencies, all of them become an object of our awareness. We are witnessing all of them. Now, one very important thing when we are using our intellect, intellect now is our mission. It's an equipment that we have for our for an investigation. How does the intellect function? How does intuition function? Intellect, whenever it wants to investigate, it cannot do by unless it divides, unless it breaks down, unless it differentiates. Give it a problem. It can't study the problem as a whole. Immediately it breaks it up. Why should the intellect do it? What to do? That is its nature and characteristics. Intellect is made that way. It is its dharma. So whatever problem we give to the intellect, solve it. Immediately it breaks it up into different parts. Every part is studied separately. And then all of them are put together to make it into a whole, completeness. But still, see, we have never, therefore, when we get a picture of the whole or the complete or the full or the solution, there are some flaws over there. I'm using these words. I'm very conscious about how, but I'm just making it very, very, simple. I have studied the entire problem or the whole, whole. I have studied the whole, whatever I wanted to study in parts. And I've collected all the parts and put them together. And I'm saying this is the picture of the whole. But I studied it in parts. Therefore, it is not 100%. When will it be 100%? Only when I study the whole as the whole. But the intellect can't do it. Why? It is a differentiating, it's a disintegrating equipment. In physics, I'm slowly bringing in physics also here. We have what is called as the differential equation. See the words over there? Differential equation. Equation means intellect over there. It's an equipment where I'm putting things. So I put the problem. The problem is called as function. I put the problem. Where do I put it? I put it into a differentiator, into a differential equation, and try to solve it. That's the intellect for all of us. Connecting the outside and the inside. So when we study, once we put it into a disintegrator, English simple meaning, it disintegrates. The problem just becomes many. And then we start solving it slowly, slowly. Simple example, in the botany class, when a flower is given to us, which family is it? Which subfamily it is? What do? We break up all, take out everything. Study part by part. Petals are studied, the stalk is studied. In the zoology class, dissection. Frog is studied, starfish is studied. We dissect it over there. In the medical college, anatomy. A body is used over there. So to know completely about the physical structure, it's all studied in parts and then put together. In the objective field, it's okay. Sometimes we can say, okay, in though I studied in part, now it looks like whole. But not so when we come to the subjective world. And also another very, very funny thing is, when I try to solve a problem, how many solutions should I get? I should get only one solution. One problem, one answer I should get. Which means one problem, one solution I am scared. In physics, when we put the problem into the differential equation, I don't get one solution. I get so many solutions. And according to the problem, we are asked to choose which solution or which answer fits into it. See the process over there? One problem, so many solutions over. In the case of, I'm coming to the other side, in the case of philosophy, it's not like that at all. We are integrating. In mathematics, we have two chapters. One chapter is called as differentiation. One chapter is called as integration. Differentiation is easier than integration. First, differentiate the chapter called differentiation. Children go through it. Only then integration. And all math students know, differentiation problems are easier to solve than integration problems. See, integration is collecting together. It's so easy to divide. But to get together everything is so difficult. So there also we integrate between upper limit and lower limit. Because what all will I integrate? Integrate means collection. How many things will I collect to solve this problem? So we are told from here to here. So from this limit, lower limit to upper limit. We're given a limit over there. And then we are asked to solve the problem. Now, intuition doesn't study the problem by dividing. The very word integration means what? I integrate. So how many other things I am given, if we put it into that equipment called the integrator, intuition, what does it do? It just swallows it all up and dissolves away all the differences. So many things I put over there. When I look into it, it will not look one. It's not like I put many there. There will be no many at all. That's the nature of the integrator. So the problem over there is studied as a whole, complete. Not in parts like how the intellect does the ocean of a difference. So when we are doing, so I'm coming to the philosophy side over here. So when we are trying to solve, now, of course, we want for one problem, one solution. And we don't want in parts. We want everything. We want a 100% solution. So what should we use? Put it into an integrator. Integrator means collects. It collects and integrates everything. Brings everything together. So as we are using our intuition, basically it becomes meditation over here. When we are trying to study or when we are doing our research, when we are searching and seeking for that truth, what is the intuition doing in us? It's collecting and it's collecting and it's collecting everything, putting it into itself and making it all one over there. The finally, what we can say, I am separate from you. Hey, integrator, I am separate from you. You give me the answer. Integrator says, sorry, you are there separate from me. My job is to integrate. You have to get into me. Only then you will get 100% solution. Because integration means what? Integrate. One only I must have. So you get into me. We don't want to get into the problem. We want to solve the problem over there. Why should I get into the problem? It says get into me first, no? You get into me. Then we'll see what happens. So I'm just dramatizing the whole thing. When we get into the integrator, we have transcended to such a level. Within us, there is no problem separate from the solution. Either we have to become a problem to solve the problem. Problem, say one. That's not nice at all. How can we become a problem to solve a problem? I want my problem to be solved. It says, get into it. Then it says, okay, you want a solution? The integrator will tell us. If you want a solution, you have to become the solution. And at that point of time, it happens. What is it that happens? Masters call it as mukti, moksha, liberation. So many words for that. Nirvana, enlightenment. So at enlightenment state, what happens? There is only one, which means the solution alone knows the solution. The solution alone can know the solution. Lord alone can know him. We're talking about the nameless, the formless, the attributeless in philosophy. Nirguna Parabrahma. It becomes the knowing principle, which becomes aware of everything. See, everything gets integrated over there. So in the integrator, it's all the many gotten to become the one. In the intellect, the one truth has become the many. Flower was the truth. I wanted the truth of it. I wanted to do some research on it. I wanted to find out many things about it. What happened? The one flower has become the many in front of us. So in science, we are always focused on the one in the many. In philosophy, the focusing is many in the one. The one truth itself expressing as the world of things and beings is one in the many. All the many are nothing but the one truth only. Many in the one is philosophical side. Now, the one in the many has been taken up exhaustively in the 10th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Easier. First sign, physics, then only metaphysics. And the many in the one is the immediate next chapter, the 11th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. See, there also, so the sequence over there, 10th chapter comes first and only then the 11th chapter comes. We can't have it the other way around. First, we have to study how the one has become the many. That is all our knowledges, outside knowledges. Only then we can integrate and make all the knowledges converge together, meet at one point. And then the many becomes the one. And that one is what is being described to us or indicated to us in our Upanishads as Brahman, the truth, the reality, ultimate reality. We can call it by any name. If to that truth we give some name form, it will become Rama, Krishna, Shiva, Devi, Ganesha, Hanumanji. All are the same. We fight over, oh, I am a devotee of Krishna. He is a devotee of Shiva. Both mean the same. It's a name form given to the highest truth, the reality behind all things and all beings. Yeah, how beautifully we are able to bring in physics and metaphysics together, or science and philosophy over here together. So everything merges over there. That is why once realization happens, for such a person, a sthita prajna or a jivan mukta, there are no doubts. There is nothing at all for them afterwards to know. Nothing, absolutely everything that has to be known has been known. We're not talking about, oh, do they know physics? Oh, do they know chemistry? No. They become the knowing principle which knows everything. So with this now, a few illustrations. Let's see how many we can go through. I have to go slowly also. Two or three. Let's see how we can apply this over here. Now, I'm sure many of you would have heard of this Einstein's theory of relativity and absolute frame of reference. Simple. What does Einstein? Relative means nothing is permanent. Opposite of permanent is relative. Opposite of absolute is relative. Absolute means single value. Never changing. Changeless. Relative means it is changing. So Einstein proposed a theory over there called the theory of relativity. And he said, all measurements which we make are all relative. Means they are not permanent. They are not constant. They are not absolute, is what he said. What did he mean? He meant length measurements. In the physics class, we do all these things. Length changes. Time changes. Now we sit and wonder over there, how can all these things change? When we are measuring the area of the room, length into area, length into breadth. Whoever measures, it will be the same. Tomorrow we measure also, it will be the same. How can length and breadth change? Now we started the class at 4 o'clock. We will end it by 5. 1 hour for all of us and for our clock also. For whoever it is, time doesn't change. How can it change? It should be absolute according to us. But Einstein says, no, it changes. Why? He said, you are participating. Little higher physics, we have to do over there. You are not an observer. You are participating over there. You are the one who is making the measurements. When you make the measurement, see, this won't hold good in the outer world. It holds good in the subatomic particle level. Atom, not even atom, electron, neutron, proton, God particle. There, all these things will make a difference. He says, you are participating in the measurement, isn't it? Of course, we are participating. When you participate, you're interfering with the measurement. When I'm measuring the length or when I'm finding out the time with the clock over there, how can I interfere and make the time change or the length change? It is not we, the physical body, it's the mind. It's the mind which interferes with the measurement. So an example for that. Supposing our mind is in a very happy, happy mind, happy mood we are. Large-hearted, magnanimous, these are all states of our, I'm calling it as the state of the mind. Our mind is in a pretty high state, good state. If the, even if it is a 1 BHK or a 2 BHK, never mind. There is space for you. There is accommodation for you. Why are you worried? There is enough space. We use these words. We in Kannada, we say, mana doddadagirbeko, mana chikkadadaru. Mind should be broad, accommodative, not the house. Even if the house is small, we can accommodate. Never mind, come. It's okay. We can somehow adjust and sit down. Don't we say that? But supposing our mind is in a nasty mode, not so good mode. Even a 10 BHK is not enough for people. We always say, she's interfering, he's interfering. I have no freedom at all. I have no space to move about. But you can go and sit in your 10 BHK, it can be. Only 4 of us. Still, we will crib. One example. For space measured, length, breadth measurements. Another example, we are now sitting in our house. House is bigger than us. Our body has got only this much. Breadth, length, etc. Weight, volume. House has got a bigger volume. So we are all sitting in the house. But supposing we go off to dream state, when we sleep, in the dream state, house is inside us. Why only house? We can go around the whole world and come. So Bangalore is there, Los Angeles is there, this side Japan is there. Everything was sitting where? Inside us. Haven't the measurements changed over there? We changed our state. Mind changed. Mind interfered. Here we are a waker. There we are a dreamer. State of the mind changed. Measurements changed. Here we were in a good mood. We were not in a good mood. The same house, space. For us, it looks different. Perspective becomes different. Time example I'll take. Supposing, the dream state and the waking state. Here we are measuring time with the waking clock. So obviously in 2 minutes, I cannot go. We can't even go to the other end of the road. How can we go abroad? Let's say to US and come back, not possible at all. But when we sleep and go off into the dream state, in the dream, we can get into an aircraft, plane, go to New York, visit our people there, and then come back as a dreamer. There we have spent, let's say, 3 days, 4 days. Fourth day, we return back to Bangalore, where in the dream. When we wake up, our waking clock will show us only 2 minutes. So in 2 minutes waking time, I have covered 4 days in the dream state of mind. Hasn't time measurement changed over here? See, it becomes, all measurements now become subjective. Another example, if any talk, it's not only my talk, any talk, if it's very interesting, time flies for us. Was it 1 hour talk? I thought it was just 10 minutes. I do not know how time flew, we say. Really, it was 1 hour? It was just like a 10 minutes talk or a 15 minutes talk. We say that. But supposing it's boring, 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 boring. Students in class keep looking at their watch. My God, only 5 minutes over? I thought half an hour is over. See, same waking state only. I'm not talking about dream state. Same waking state, my mind has decided what is the time over there. So if things are okay, time flies. Time measurement becomes different. If things are not okay, time drags for us. Time measurements will be different. So therefore, Einstein is justified in saying space and time measurements are relative. They are not absolute. They depend on the person who is making the observation or the participant over there. And more so, it is subjective. So all measurements ultimately will become subjective for us. That's how we lead our lives. Everything is with respect to me, with respect to me. For me, is space enough or not enough? With respect to me, did time go slow or did time go fast? According to that, our life's experiences. It's all relative only. So therefore, in physics, what they tried to do was, they tried to find out, can we find out something? From there, if we make measurements, it should give me only one value. No changing, changing, changing. Some frame of reference. Now for us, our frame of reference or our reference point is the mind. As the mind, so the time and space measurements. Can we find a state? In physics, we will call it as the frame of reference. Can we find out a frame of reference, an absolute frame of reference, an absolute state? Can we find that? From where, if I measure anything, length, breadth, volume, time, anything I measure, it should not change. It should be the same. They did these experiments. Two scientists called Michelson and Morley. They did the experiment and they got the negative results, which means in the outer world, there is no absolute frame of reference at all. We can't find one single state wherein if we hold on to or get into that state, like now how we get into mental state, get into that state and make measurements, space-time measurement, I get the same value, not possible. But in philosophy, it is possible. What is that state? God's state of realization. God's state of consciousness is an absolute state, having reached which, if we are rooted there, if we are well established over there, if we are identified with that, and then make measurements outside, it'll always be the same. It will not change. That's where our masters are. All our great masters who have realized, that's where they all are. And he even said, Einstein, not only length, breadth, height, volume, space, not only time, he even said, even the mass changes, matter changes. How can the weight or mass of this pen change? If I weigh, wherever I weigh, it will be the same. But he says, no, no, no. The mass, the matter content, the number of matter particles, they change. Now, obviously, it cannot happen in the outer world. We are talking about something which is very, very subjective. And he said over there, at some point of time, matter becomes infinite. Infinite means what? This pen is becoming bigger and bigger and expanding and expanding and expanding. If the pen expands, it will become all pervading. So if we reach that state, according to our science, the velocity of light is maximum. We can't have velocity greater than velocity of light. That's the problem for all our physics problems. We can't have any speed. We use the word velocity. if somebody has a doubt, can all the doubts be later on, please? Because I will lose my line of thought. Later on, you can put it, you can forward them, and then I can clarify for you. So therefore, over here, this keeps expanding. Why? Speed of light is what I was talking. In our science, speed of light is the maximum. We can't think of anything having a speed greater than speed of light. Why? No, that's a limitation. They said you can't have. But mind speed is more than light speed, which is not taken into account in physics, in science. Manovega, we say. Mind can travel faster than light. So here we are. Right now we can be in New York. And if we can connect telepathy, whatever signal I want to send, that person will pick it up. Though light travels very fast, mind travels even beyond that. So which means I am a mass particle. I have got certain weight, my mass. It looks like I've become all pervading. I've gone up to there. I've extended, and gone to New York and touched her. Therefore, she got whatever I wanted to communicate, she has received it. How? I expanded. I mean, in quotes I'm putting. So therefore, he said, even mass at that level, we're talking about philosophical perspective, philosophical viewpoint over there. Even mass changes. It's not a constant. And at the point of realization, what we call as enlightenment, liberation, mass becomes infinite. Infinite means what? All pervading. That's how we describe our God. God is all pervading. He is a mass, infinite mass of consciousness. These are the words that we use for him. So this is about absolute frame of reference and Einstein's theory of relativity. Next, again, I want to take up Einstein's mass energy equivalence. We are told in physics, matter is separate, energy is separate. In philosophy, we use the word matter and spirit. We don't use the word matter and energy. Spirit means what? Spiritual energy, spiritual vibration. That's all it is. So mass is separate, energy is separate. In the school level, definitely they are different. There's no way that the two of them have got any similarity between the two at all. As we go higher and higher and higher, knowledges start becoming one over there. Different aspects start merging over there. And at one point of time, we find that mass can get converted to energy and energy can get converted to mass. That is what Einstein said. Now, easy, this much of mass I destroy, I can get energy. That we understand. But this much of energy, can I make it into a mass? Can I take some energy from the cosmos and make it into a particle like this or as an object like this, which has got mass? Little difficult for us to understand. But he said it is possible. At the highest level, it is possible. So mass is there, energy is there, they're equivalent to each other. They keep on changing. Now, so something is there. What is that something? He didn't say. There is something which operates as mass and energy, which operates as mass and spirit, which operates as mass means particle. Energy means wave. We always say energy travels in waves. So there is a theory which we call as wave particle dual nature. Dual means two. Anything can remain in particle aspect. It can show us particle properties, or it can just decide to change and show us energy properties. It is possible, is what he said. Now, how to relate it to philosophy? We have our Prakriti and Purusha. Matter and energy, their properties are completely contradictory with each other. Mass I can see, energy I cannot see. How are the properties the same? Therefore, they chose in Vedanta, they chose to call it Prakriti and Purusha. From where do Prakriti and Purusha come? They come from that one single truth. Equivalence over there. Nothing like this is this much percent and this is this much percentage. No, both are equal. He uses E is equal to MC squared. In philosophy, there is no E equal to MC squared at all. 50-50. Prakriti and Purusha, the he part and the she part are both given the same importance. Both of them have got the same relevance. We call it a he and we call it a she because they have contradictory or exactly opposite properties. And that has been very beautifully deified for us as Ardha Narishwara. Ardha Narishwara. Half man, half woman. Shankaracharya has given us a very beautiful stotra. Ardha Narishwara stotra he has given to us. Where he describes the proper, he has given a form over there. Because mind needs a form. So therefore, all the properties of Prakriti, Mother Goddess, all the properties of Purusha, Ishwara, father or mother and father, Prakriti and Purusha, he and she, different properties are given. Both are so contradictory with each other. It's like, you know, we can never even bring them together, but they so beautifully complement each other. Whole Ardha Narishwara Stotra we can do. Scientifically we can do it. So though they have got exactly, we call it a Tadviruddha Lakshana. Tadviruddha means opposite, conflicting, contradictory properties. But they all align themselves so beautifully. They come together so beautifully. In fact, they complement each other. So only now we have women's right, woman dominating, male dominating, all those things. Earlier it was not there at all. Everything is 50-50. I don't want to go into that because then this will not move further. So therefore, Einstein's E is equal to MC squared. His wave particle dual nature, he says matter waves exist. But we can't see it. At this level, we can't see. Even he can't show. But it has been discovered. These are all revelations. How the mantras were all revealed to the rishis and then they wrote it down, which became our scripture. Nobody sat down there and said, let me write down. And then they wrote over there using the alphabets. No, it's all a revelation. Only now we have books. Now it is all recorded. It was all revealed to them. Truths were revealed. Scientists also say big breakthrough. I had a big revelation, they will say. They will never say I discovered. That is all our words. Discovered, invented. Revelations, they're all. It just happened. It just comes into them. These truths descend. So all our, whatever we have in the science field are all truths. Nothing to be denied over there. They're all beautiful truths which have been discovered. But they're not 100%. When will we reach 100% when we enter, where we have to leave Einstein's realm and enter into Adi Shankara's realm? And then sit down and do our meditation, contemplation seriously. Long hours of intense contemplation. Chances are, first we have to become an integrator. First thing is we are a differentiator now. Anything we divide, anything it can be. How was it? Okay, but we add the word. We've divided there. We have to first become an integrator. For that we start from wherever we are. Outside world we integrate. Where is integration? Everywhere we are fighting. Outside also. If outside is like that, whatever we see outside is a reflection of what is inside. So therefore we start becoming an integrated person. That's why value system, integrate yourself. So we slowly start from there. Then only we can hope to become an integrator in our seat of meditation. So this is one aspect of Einstein. The other one I'd like to take is, there's a very beautiful principle called as uncertainty principle. The scientist who gave it to us is Heisenberg. That's his name. So we call it as Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. What is uncertain? Of course, I can measure everything. He says, no, nothing can be measured properly. He says, when a particle is moving accurately, I can't measure where it is. I can't localize it. I can't pinpoint and say the particle is here. Neither I can see how fast it is moving. I mean, in the outside world, it doesn't fit in. But I'm just giving an example. He said, we can't make out the static part and the dynamic part. Static means something is at rest. Dynamic means something is moving. He said, when we try to make measurements as to whether something is at rest, static case, or something is moving, dynamic case, nothing is sure. Everything becomes uncertain. I can't even find out where it is. I can't even find out whether it is moving or whether it is static. Applied to our philosophy, it means I do not know whether this is in the field of activity, whether it is active or non-active. So for the word static and dynamic, we will have to use the word action and actionlessness. We are told over there, a poet is, for example, sitting over there. What is he doing? He's thinking. Thinking of something because he wants to write a poem. From our standpoint, he is not doing anything. He is in the state of actionlessness. Ask him, vigorously he is active inside. See, contradictory over there. Now, whether we should say he is active, he is in action, or whether we should say he is not in action, big question mark over there. That is what the scientist said. Everything is uncertain. Nothing can be determined properly. Indeterminate, everything becomes indeterminate. When we come to philosophy, Krishna in the fourth chapter, we are doing the fourth chapter now. He says very beautifully, it's supposed to be a very, very important shloka, very tough to interpret it, difficult. Karmani akarma yappashet, karmani akarma. Inactivity, one who can see non-activity. Karmani akarma, opposite of each other, karma and akarma. In karma, inactivity, to see no activity. And the other way around also. In no activity, to see activity. Who can do it? Krishna says only a realized person knows everything about it. Obviously, we all can't know about it. Therefore, everything becomes uncertain, uncertain, uncertain. Uncertain means always there is ignorance. Somewhere there is a level of ignorance in us. That is called as spiritual ignorance. That is called as Maya. So if we go beyond Maya, yes, we will be able to measure everything properly. Why? Everything has become one. So one who can see activity in non-activity and non-activity in activity is a man of realization. The Rasa Krida of Krishna, it takes 2 hours to do that one topic. Oh, what is that? Krishna dance with all the gopis. It comes in Bhagavad Puran. That one little topic called Rasa Krida has got so much of philosophy for us. It takes minimum 2 hours. It is action in inaction and inaction in action, dramatized so beautifully for us by Krishna in the form of that Rasa Krida. It's a very, very beautiful concept. So next, I'm just going through it a little faster because another one or two I want, so that we know we can take back something really solid with us. We have one topic called as crystallography, where we study crystals. Salt crystal, sugar crystal, diamond crystal. We know what crystals are. So there is a branch there. We are talking about perfect crystals and imperfect crystals. Maybe Shuddha salt, Tata salt, pure salt. Even the powdered salt is also tiny, tiny crystals. Finest powder is also finest crystal. every one of them is a tiny little crystal over there. It exists in crystal form. So we have said Shuddha, pure sugar, pure salt, pure 100% diamond. Mean there are no impurities over there, which we can see, which all our outside equipment, if you put it to test, it will say 100% pure salt or sugar or diamond. But when we go through this in physics class, there are certain faults or defects inside the crystal. Therefore, we call it as imperfect crystal, which we can't see, which the equipment outside cannot even see. They're called as, I'm just giving out the line defect, point defect, line imperfection, point imperfection. Where is it? Inside the crystal, atoms and all those things. Why are all those imperfections? Therefore, we say imperfect. So our 100% Shuddha sugar and the salt in the kitchen and the diamonds we are wearing, all of them have defects in them. All of them are imperfect. Why? If these imperfections, supposing we want to remove the imperfection, let me remove all the defects. So bring a little bit of sugar, keep it over there, and then some experiment over there wherein I can remove all the inside defects, flaws. Now to remove impurities, we know what we do. We heat it up. Supply energy, supply energy, supply energy. Slowly, slowly the impurities will come out. Slowly, slowly the imperfections also will come out. When all the imperfections come out, for the little bit of sugar that we are having in front of us, the sugar will vanish. I had 1 kg of sugar in front of me. I paid so much for it. I wanted to remove the imperfections that are there inside it, which I learned in my physics class. Therefore, I supplied so much of energy to it, wanting to make it purest sugar. What happened to the sugar? Vanished into thin air. Similarly will be salt. Similarly will be the diamonds also. Why? Because for a crystal to remain as a crystal in front of us, however small it is, these imperfections are needed. See, the irony of it, for a crystal to remain as a crystal, however small it is, these imperfections are needed. It's a part of it, integral part. It's not an impurity, outside impurity, which I can take it away. It's a part. So the imperfection is an integral part, an inside part of it. It's a part of it. If we try to remove these imperfections, it'll lose. It just goes, the substance disappears. What held that crystal together was the imperfection. Similarly, also, we also have one crystal called the mind in us. The mind is an imperfect instrument. My guru used to say, so we'll start purifying the mind. Why are there imperfections and defects in our mind? Swami used to say, manufacturer's defect. When the mind was in a lighter way, when the mind was put into all of us, not that he put it, we have brought it with us, it's a faulty instrument. Even the best mind is a faulty instrument. That is why they say, shuddha karo, purify the mind, purify the mind, purify the mind. When we go on purifying the mind, purifying the mind, purifying the mind, we know what will happen. We know what happened to the sugar in front of us. So what will we do there? We don't supply energy and heat. We do sadhana over there. Sadhana is heat. We call it as tapas. It comes from the word tapa. Tapa means heat. So in the heat of our spiritual practices, the sadhana that we do, the mind starts becoming purer and purer and purer and purer. Purest mind, I'm adding over there. Because pure sattva mind is still, sattva is also a defect, which has to go away for realization. Therefore, the purest mind is no mind. Therefore, we are told at that point of time, When a person realizes he has reached the no mind state. Why? Pure mind is no mind, we can say. Or we can say pure mind is Brahman. Integration has come over. See, this is the lesson we get from perfect and imperfect crystals. I will complete it with just another illustration, maybe another 2 or 3 minutes. There is another topic in physics which we call it thermodynamics. Heat. Basically, we are studying heat over the engines. So there we study efficiency of an engine. How efficient is this engine? We have got motors, 1 HP, 2 HP, half HP. That is called as the efficiency. 1 HP means very efficient. 2 HP, even more efficient. So we study efficiency of engines. Now they discovered everything, whatever we do at the manufacturing level in the factory, efficiency cannot be stepped up beyond 20%. See where we are. And we are saying, I mean, a perfect world. Everything is perfect. Nothing is perfect. We are talking about perfection, which is far, far, far away from us, far removed from us. So they found even the most perfect engine, which has been manufactured, small or big, the most efficient one, only 20%. So they tried to do other things. You know, reduce the friction over there, make this all right, make that all right. Machinery, engine. Try to do everything still. Yes, efficiency will go up little, but it won't go up large scale. Why was the question? Suddenly they found out engine is functioning, but the engine is here. It takes from somewhere. It gives somewhere. Isn't it? Output, input, we say. The engine takes from somewhere, energy. It does some work over there. And it is giving out something useful for all of us. So if the engine is in the middle, we have on either side, it takes from here and it gives out here. Very funny, they discovered. In physics, they have discovered thermodynamics. The efficiency of an engine does not depend on anything else, not on the metal. We say iron gets rusted. Let's use steel. Let's polish this, so that no friction is there, nothing. What does the efficiency of the engine depend on? It doesn't depend on it. Strangely, it depends on what is on this side from where it is taking. What is on this side where it is giving? Wonder of wonder, these are the little miracles over. Applying to ourselves. We are all imperfect. Why? First of all, mind is there inside. The most imperfect equipment that we have. If we try to make it perfect, make it perfect, make it perfect, yes, we become the all perfect. So if the engine should become 100% efficient, any engine, 100% efficient, from where it draws energy should be an infinite source. And where it is delivering the goods should also be an infinite situation. The infinite is the word we use for God. Use the word for truth, Ananta. Ananta means no beginning, no middle, no end. All pervading, infinite is what we say. So the engine, whatever it is, whichever it is, must function. And where should it draw energy from? Ananta, infinite. And where should it deliver its good? Infinite situation. Only then it looks like, how can the engine have got anything to do with these two? But it has. So that is why in physics limitation will come. Therefore, we can never step up the efficiency. So therefore, the efficiency will be low, because this is a finite engine. Finite. It's even it's got a shape and a weight, etc. It's not infinite. It's not all-pervading. A master who has realized, where has he reached? He has reached the all-perfect state. He has reached the all-pervading state. He has reached the state of infinitude. Therefore, when he is working, Where is he drawing from? He's drawing from infinity, infinite source. When a master is working for the welfare of the world outside, because he has transcended his mind, he has transcended his body, mind, and intellect. So the body of the master that we see is just an instrument over there. Who is using it? Lord is using it. For what? For our welfare. That is why we say Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwara, Guru Sakshat Parabrahma. He's not a person over there. Who is he? He is infinite. He is God himself, infinite. From where is he drawing? From infinite source. Supreme will, Lord's will, functioning through Lord. For the sake of what? For the sake of the universe, which is nothing but he himself in another form, which is also infinite on this side. See, integration, infinite, working through infinite, delivering through infinite, delivering to infinite. Only then it can be 100% in a perfect, 100% efficiency. Such an engine we call as a perfect engine. Therefore, we speak of our masters as all perfect, in the state of absolute state, no change, all pervading, no beginning, no middle, no ananta. They have reached that state beyond everything. No cause effect relationship can touch them. No space time measurements can touch them. They are in that all perfect state, which they have reached by transcending all these equipment, the body, the mind, and the intellect. Of course, there is more. There is lots more. Like I said, we have not again touched the tip of the iceberg. But then the clock in front of me says 5:10. So we have extended it. So therefore, I'd like to conclude we can think about it. More things will get revealed to us also. Especially if we are a science student, we can apply it to every field. We can even apply it to our cooking lessons and classes also. It's just how we apply philosophy. So when we apply philosophy to whatever, in the puja room or in the kitchen or in the office, once we apply philosophy over there, it becomes religion. Where many of us say, oh, I am spiritual, but I'm not religious. What does religion mean? It's not just rituals over there. When we apply the philosophy to our fields of activity, it becomes religion over there. Therefore, we write on values over there. Rituals there have got a meaning because they're all dramatization of what we do inside. What we must be doing inside, they put it all outside and we call them all rituals over there. Whether giving bath to God, lighting the lamp, Aarti, Naivedyam, Dhoop, anything it can be. All the rituals are a dramatization of what should be done within to reach that highest state of God realization. So with this, I'd like to conclude my talk on science and philosophy. Thank you so much for having given me a very, very patient listening. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I think I can accurately say on behalf of everyone, we felt like we were transported back to our school days, our college days. It was, Asha's giving a thumbs up. You know, it's what sitting in front of you for one of your lectures and discourses always leaves us with so many more questions. So I can say thank you so much for, you know, transporting us back. And it was even slightly better than those days because we know that you're not going to call on any of us and ask us any questions. So we feel very good about that. And I can also say that this definitely 1 hour felt like 10 minutes. The time flew by.
Okay. Any doubt? Somebody had a doubt? You can share doubts to Shaina and she will forward it to me. Sure. And if I know the answer, sure, I will answer them.
Yes, absolutely. And as I mentioned, I will put my phone number in the chat so anyone can just send me a message to be added to the group. or to ask any questions that I can then forward to ma'am. So I've just sent the number in the chat. So thank you once again, ma'am. And
thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.